So here are my examples, and I've got a whole bunch of them because, well, this is a complicated question, and reality has shown how complicated it is. A few years ago, the question of same-sex marriage led to a raging debate across this country. Parliament and the Supreme Court received countless submissions from groups on both sides of the argument. Those who opposed same-sex marriage brought forward religious, moral, psychological, sociological, and other resources and arguments about why same-sex marriage was bad for society, bad for children, etc. And you can imagine how hurtful, offensive, and even hateful some of those arguments surely were. But what would the alternative to this debate have looked like? Should the Supreme Court have made a decision like this without hearing all sides? Should Parliament have said, sure, come on in, bring your submissions, except for you people who are anti-equality? The debate was a real one, the question was of fundamental importance, and the result was tremendous. Canada is one of the first, and still one of the only countries in the world to have recognized same-sex marriage. It would have been far less of a victory if it had been accomplished in an unbalanced, undemocratic kind of way. So, how do we separate the good speech from the bad? Well, none of the submissions to Parliament or the Supreme Court went before a Human Rights Commission. But a tiny little conservative Catholic magazine called Catholic Insight did have a complaint launched against it for having made the same kind of arguments relying on the same kind of religious, psychological, scientific, etc. texts. And the Canadian Human Rights Commission eventually dismissed the complaint. Process works? Well, the magazine is still facing judicial review of that decision and so far has spent, according to them, $20,000 in legal fees. Is that a victory? What if the gay rights activists wanted to respond in kind and say fighting words against the Catholic magazines and others who support them? Or what if a group of feminists get up, as happened not that long ago, and denounce the practice of polygamy and all who practice it? Would this be the good, equality-seeking speech that we like? Or would it be hateful speech against a particular religious group? You tell me. Or take the publishing of the Danish Muhammad cartoons. These cartoons, despite, aside from being provocative, really were offensive. They included a lot of stereotypical images of Muslims. But they were also the subject of enormous international attention, as we know. Should they have been banned from public view? That complaint before the Alberta Human Rights Commission was also dismissed. It took a mere 2 years, and they reported $100,000. Yet another victory for free speech, right? Thank you. As we know, the complaints against Maclean's magazine were dismissed because they were not hateful enough. But if we look at the hallmarks of hate as set out by that same commission, it's very hard to understand how they reached the conclusion. In that article, Muslims were compared to mosquitoes. They were portrayed as violent and aggressive, interested in world domination. I mean, how more hateful can you get? So I'll give you two more examples, and then I'll move on to another point. Israeli apartheid. Now, there's a term that has university administrators completely befuddled. Is this legitimate political expression advocacy for the disadvantaged and the oppressed? Or is it thinly veiled and unfair anti-Semitism? Does it have to be one or the other? The attempt to put this kind of speech into categories is what our hate speech laws, including the human rights laws, require. And if you think Israeli apartheid is an offensive term, listen to this. And I'll skip bits of it, but it starts like this. I quote, pick a Muslim country, any Muslim country, and the most brutal humiliations will grab you by the vitals. In Pakistan, an average of 2 women every day die from honor killings, often with Allah's name on the lips of the murderers. Then we go on to Mali and Mauritania, slavery by Muslims. In Sudan, slavery by Muslims. Christians being shot point blank by Muslims, and so on. I skip on, and I'm quoting still. Even in Toronto, whose culture differs markedly from that of Bangladesh, she's never been subjected to a human rights complaint so far. But how would the commissions know whether this is hateful speech or self-critical speech calling for reform? And again, can we tell the difference? Is there? Does it matter? So if the chilling of everybody's speech, and it is everybody, is affected by these hate speech restrictions, what are the benefits? What have we gained by them? And I appreciate that some of the speech really is hard to take. It really is hurtful and has an impact. But law is not the only way to affect change. And what these laws are doing is creating risks. And there are other means at our disposal, like social pressure and disapproval. David Ahenikew said some horrible things about Jews, about them deserving to die under Hitler during the Holocaust, etc., etc. After he said these things, his world fell in. He was vilified, he was ostracized. It was public pressure and outrage, not the law, that resulted in his being stripped of his formal leadership position in the First Nations community, stripped of his Order of Canada. It was because of public pressure that he publicly apologized, that he lost the respect that he had been held in, that many leaders in the First Nations community distanced themselves from him and reached out to build bridges with the Jewish community. So, first of all, this guy showed his true colors, and some good resulted from the horrible things that he said. And the hate laws that did come in, they did try and convict him as well. What have they accomplished in the David Ahenikew case? So far, 3 years plus in, no conviction. But every time there's an appeal, we have to hear once again the awful stuff that he said. I'll conclude with the following thoughts. First of all, as some of us probably have noticed, the world we live in is not a perfect place. And so those of us who have idealistic values, it's going to be disappointing to conclude that we're not going to reach a perfect answer. But we're not. Yeah. Secondly, if we truly accept that there is value in diversity of opinion, in freedom of conscience, in freedom of belief, then we're going to have to accept that other people are going to hold beliefs, of course not us, but other people are going to have to hold beliefs that we find silly or offensive, and in some cases even repulsive. From a more mercenary perspective, at least this way, we're helping to secure a basic foundation of values that will protect us and our beliefs even when we, whoever we is, are no longer in the majority. And for now, that is the equality seekers, but not all equality seekers and not on all fronts. Finally, free expression. Despite those people who are still claiming it, it is a flag worth flying. It has value not just in its own right, for creativity, for innovation, for self-fulfillment, but it's a right on which many of our other freedoms depend, including equality. We can't search for truth, fight for a fair society, protect minority interests, shed light on injustice, without having open and robust debate, without having a free press, and without having freedom of expression just tucked there into our back pockets in case we need it. Because chances are, we're going to need it. Thank you.